Welcome to your commercial-free, uninterrupted investment show, sponsored by the SEC-registered investment firm, Wilsey Asset Management, a fiduciary firm owned and operated by President Brent Wilsey, who has been putting clients' investment needs first for over 40 years. The Smart Investing Show has been giving unbiased financial information for over 27 years on local radio stations right here in San Diego, providing you with fundamental analysis on stocks and investments you want to know about. Now, here are your hosts, Brent and Chase Wilsey.
Well, hello, and welcome to the Smart Investing Show. I'm Brent Wilsey, president of Wilsey Asset Management. Great to have you here on the show. We got a big show planned today, a lot of great things to talk about, make you a smarter investor as always. What we're going to start off with is some topics to help help you understand what is going on. We're going to talk about the AI boom. What's going on? You missed NVIDIA. What should you do? We'll talk about that. We're seeing bond allocation, that's bonds in the portfolio, from people coming in to see us. We just don't get why they have bonds in the portfolio. We'll explain that when we get to that segment. And then also, too, we're going to discuss the tariffs on Chinese goods, what that means for you, inflation-wise, investment-wise, and maybe for the country as well. With me is Chase. Chase, what do we got?
We got a lot of exciting things, as always. Got a few good companies here we're going to break down. First one we're going to look at, Home Depot. I'm sure we're well aware of the name Home Depot there. They reported earnings last week. Got some kind of surprising news. We'll dig through on the details there. Also, too, we're going to look at Altria, the cigarette company, tobacco company. I know they do stuff outside of just cigarettes. And then lastly, we want to look at Zoetis, I believe is how you say it. I feel like you always pick these hard names and make me say them first. But Zoetis is a kind of pets, kind of a pet play, I guess, is what I'll look at, because, you know, so many people love their animals, which, you know, I have two dogs. I love my dogs. So, you know, I kind of get it. But, you know, it's a potential profit machine for, you know, people that have pets, because it's pharmaceutical based, I believe, spin out from Pfizer years ago. So got some few companies there. We're very excited to look at them.
All right. Well, let's get right into it. Let's talk about the AI boom, because you may have missed the AI boom in NVIDIA. They just reported earnings this past week here. But for the patient, longer-term investor, there could be a good investment opportunity in energy going forward. As more companies begin to use AI, the demand for energy will increase. Keep in mind that this is in on top of the expected growth in the electric vehicle market, and if it continues in future years, well, cryptocurrency is also a drain on electricity to mine all those silly tokens.
Now, to give you an example on the power needed for AI, a ChatGPT request takes roughly 10 times as much power compared to if one did a Google search. Now, based on some research from Bank of America, they estimate that the current demand for electricity from data centers is currently 1 to 2%. But in the next 7 years, that could increase to 8%. I mean, gosh, that's four times more than we're at now.
400% increase.
That's a problem, I'm going to say, for the electric grid. There will be some great opportunities for the investor who is looking out 3 to 5 years if they invest in good, fundamentally strong companies. The nice thing about many energy companies is they also pay a decent dividend while you wait for the investment to grow.
And the hard part, Chase, is, okay, so what do we invest in? Do we invest in natural gas? Invest in oil? Do you invest in utilities? I mean, this is it's a big field that's going to benefit from this. And the thing is, you still want to get things on sale. You don't want to overpay for things, because that hurts your compounded growth down the road. But you got to be patient, find the right investment, and this is a way you can benefit. And I've often thought about this now, because you charge your car at home many times. Maybe you have solar, but you're charging your phones, your iPads, your computers. I mean, you're using AI. Maybe you are a crypto investor, or you're a miner, whatever. I mean, there's just so many things. And I've worried in the past that, you know, are we going to have blackouts like we had years ago? I think they're avoiding that, but the demand is going to be huge.
Not even years ago. I mean, Texas has had issues with the electric grid there. And, I mean, you've had different storms that have come in as well, and caused problems with electricity. The problem is, people want electricity so bad, but we don't have the electric grid set up to a place that it's, I'm going to say, sustainable quite yet, to grow to the place that people want it to be. Again, if EVs took off the way that people wanted it to or thought they were going to a couple years ago, I think we'd have even more problems, obviously. But when we look at this, I think it's very interesting. And, you know, I'm going to kind of pull people in on some conversations we've been having here in the office. You know, we actually, I'm going to let people know, is we made a big sell in our portfolio this week, and it was an energy company. But they were primarily looking at gasoline and diesel. I don't see that being a big beneficiary from the electric grid, obviously.
Right.
But if you can find companies that are in the energy space, I think natural gas could be a huge beneficiary here.
And to kind of give you some perspective, we can't name the name of the company, but just give you some perspective. Started doing this company back in, I think it was like 2009, maybe 2008. The returns that we got from that time frame are anywhere between 500 to 900%. That's what we're kind of talking about here with energy. We were trying to find something at the beginning, because why did that do so well? Because of the demand and the growing sales and earnings. Well, that's what we're talking about here with investing in the energy side, because as the demand for electricity is there, prices will go up, demand will go up, more energy will be produced, and the investors in the right things 5, 10, 15 years and I'll say, like, wow, I made a great return on that.
And I'll give people kind of some areas that I have my eye on. Not at these levels, I'll tell you that right now, but yeah. On pullbacks, I mean, I think the integrated energy companies are interesting. You talk about Exxon, Chevron. I think the pure natural gas plays, that's some potential. I mean, solar companies, unfortunately, they've just gone through the roof here the last few weeks. But, you know, there could be some solar companies that are profitable that could make some sense. And utilities. But the problem is, again, utilities have done so well as of late. But I think those areas on a pullback, and you might get one where the whole stock market pulls back, and you might be able to kind of take advantage of that as an investor to find really good companies in those potential areas that, again, could be great investments 3, 4, 5 years down the road.
And we always talk about being patient. We talked about this today at the office, that the market does have a 10% correction about once a year. Well, not to say that's going to happen every time once a year. But just think, the last time we had a 10% correction was started, what, March of last year. So now we're going on 14 months. Could have happened next month. Could have happened 6 months. It's going to happen. So be patient when it comes to investing, to try to find things on sale, because it will happen. It's not like we'll never have another 10% correction. That's when I want to look at perhaps then the solar companies, the energy companies could drop 10, maybe 15%. That is when you say, okay, now step in and buy this investment for the next 5, 10, 15 years, and I'll have great returns. And some of them pay dividends, great dividends.
Yeah, and the other thing I want to say, too, about the pullback is, I mean, the market, the S&P 500, it now trades, I believe, over 21 times earnings. We know the average over the last 25 years, which, again, that's still inclusive of the end of the tech boom, around 16 and a half times. So 21 times is definitely in the upper tier there. We do not have an inexpensive market. So I think you're right. I mean, you got to be ready on those pullbacks. I don't know when they're going to happen. And I think last week we talked about how we're sitting on more cash than normal. It's hard to find things to buy at this rate. Everything is so expensive. But that doesn't mean you can't find something with, you know, 5, 10% pullback. I mean, I think you could find some great opportunities. There's things that have, I'm going to say, good valuations, but we want to find those great valuations.
Exactly. So that's a way to play the AI boom, is by looking at energy. Well, let's talk about something that we see, a bond allocation. And again, when we see potential clients come to our office or for our firm for a consultation, and we see they have 10%, I don't know, maybe 30% allocation of bonds, I just scratch my head and wonder, what was the broker thinking? And then I think, well, maybe they weren't thinking. Even the bond king, Bill Gross, who managed the PIMCO Total Return Fund, and was largely responsible for bringing the investment firm PIMCO from assets, I was shocked when I read this, from assets from under management of $12 million to around $2 trillion. He has said he now dislikes bonds and investing money in other areas. He has some of the best returns of bond fund managers. But it came at a time of declining interest rates from 1981 to 2020, and that's now over. So why would a broker or advisor be putting any money into bonds? I just don't get it.
Yeah, and with long-term interest rates at current levels, I believe the best return that investors could hope for is probably the coupon rate, which is on the 10-year treasury, somewhere around 4.5%. This will not only hurt bonds, I believe it will also lead to disappointing returns on the old asset allocation model of 60% in equities and 40% in bonds over the next 5 to 10 years. So if your broker or advisor has part of your money in bonds, you may want to ask, well, why are we doing that? And I would say, be prepared for the weak answer of something to do with asset allocation, risk tolerance, you know, how do you feel about it? We got to, you know, subdue market volatility. Or something to the fact that, well, it's worked in the past. In other words, they aren't really taking the time to do the hard research for your portfolio, and they're kind of just taking the easy way out, sticking to rules of thumb. And I don't know. I think bonds, and it's funny, even when I was looking at the article we referenced here with Bill Gross, I think his returns on bonds, even during a great environment, was still like 6% per year.
Yeah.
It wasn't even that good.
It was like 6.67, I think, was the returns. And, you know, and for bonds, that was pretty impressive. But we still look at the other thing with bonds. We always talk about a bond, you get a 10-year bond. Your interest rate is going to be the same for 10 years. We talked about this, one of the companies we'll mention later on. They've increased the dividend, I think, over the last 10 years by, I think, 80%. That will happen when you get dividend-paying stocks. Now, yes, you're going to have more volatility. Volatility is not risk. You're not going to lose the money as long as you do your research. But you're going to get better returns, and especially when they grow the dividends. That never happens with a bond.
And interest is taxed at a higher rate. It's at an income rather than, you know, tax-favored dividends. So I don't want to say we'll never be in bonds, but I think bonds have to be very attractive because I just don't see the long-term returns. And I think, again, the reason bonds are put into portfolios is to appease people's short-term concerns. Bonds are not a great long-term investment. They're really not when you think about it.
Yeah.
And as I said, Bill Gross, what do you say, 6-7% is what he averaged. And that is a great return on bonds during a time period when it was easy to invest in bonds. Stocks did way better during that time period. It just doesn't make any sense.
And he made 6-7%. Now he's saying, don't invest in the bonds. So he was doing 6-7%. Now in bonds, he might be thinking, if you do 2-4, that's not very good. So again, I just don't know why anybody in their portfolio would have bonds, especially now with cash rates being as high as they are. But I think brokers, they just do stuff like just to try to make a sale, do an asset allocation, put 60% equities, 40% in bonds. We use mutual funds, we use ETFs. Okay, you're fine. Let me go to the next person, talk to them. And then we'll meet once a year so I can get referrals from you to try to get more people to do the same asset allocation. They don't think about investing what's best for the investment for the client.
And I truly believe that there is very little that an advisor can do to justify charging a fee on bonds. You know, when we talk about building a portfolio, when it comes to finding good quality companies, I mean, not many people have the type of time to do the research that we do. Well, if you buy, let's say, the 10-year treasury, why in the heck would you pay an advisor 1% to put you in a 10-year treasury?
Right.
Now that just brings down your interest rate by 1%. It doesn't make any sense. And I mean, I was looking at the total bond market index. I had this number here. If you look at the beginning of 2021, your total return, the price return is you're down about 18%.
You're down 18% price return. Now, that doesn't include the interest, though.
That doesn't include the interest. The current yield on the bond index is now 3.3%. But that means prior to this, I would assume at the beginning of 2021, on the bond index, it was maybe 1% to 2%.
Yeah. And so if you assume 2%, so you got over 3 years, you got 6% in interest, but you lost 18%, so your net return is 12%.
Yeah.
Not a good deal. A good deal. And it could take you, I would say, maybe 3 more years just to break even.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. I don't know. If you can't tell, we're not big fans of bonds. I think, again,
I don't think anybody can tell that.
Yeah. And I don't know if I would ever use long-term bonds again. And the theory is that as rates obviously go back down, well, that's when bond prices go up.
Right.
But I don't think you're going to see rates fall. I mean, you're talking about the 70s when rates were in the double digits. I just don't see that same opportunity arising.
I did use back in 2006, 2007. I was investing some money in bonds, but I was getting like a 7-8% yield.
Was that intermediate corporates? Is that what you're using?
I think I was using an ETF or a fund to actually do it. But then I sold them because of the appreciation.
Yeah.
I mean, when it dropped, like, well, wow, not only did I get the 7% yield, but now I got appreciation because rates went down. So when you invest in bonds, rates should be higher, so that when they fall, you get the yield plus the appreciation. Not investing when rates are 4-5% because they go up, you're going to lose money.
Yeah, so. And I think the risk that bonds go from where they are now to a little bit higher is about the same as if rates were to fall.
Right.
So I think that's why we said, you know, best case scenario, I think you make money based off the yield on the coupon. That's about it.
Yeah, and a lot of people listen to our show for advice, and I'll give you some advice here. Call your broker and say, simple question, why am I on bonds? And see what they come back with. You should know the answer to that question. All right, let's move on to tariffs on Chinese goods. Now, I was happy to see the Biden administration boost tariffs on Chinese goods from electric vehicles to steel, aluminum. Unfortunately, I'm worried about Newton's law that every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. The Chinese government will probably counter against these measures by targeting the imports that they receive from us and U.S. businesses. Two that come to mind are Apple's iPhones and Tesla's cars. That's going to really hurt these companies, and I believe that's what the Chinese want to do in response. The Chinese economy is suffering, and they are producing far more than they absorb domestically. As an example, they are now producing 7 times the number of electric vehicles they did in 2019, and consumers don't have the money to buy them.
They have also been a big producer of solar cells, and they, too, are up 500% between 2018 and 2023. I think I saw numbers as well that they were only utilizing something crazy like 25% of their capacity. They've just overbuilt the capacity for solar cells there or solar manufacturing. I mean, it's just insane what they've done to really depress prices. Now, China has seen their global exports increase by 14%, but exports to the G7 countries now only account for 29% of those exports. This is far below the 48% it was in the year 2000. My guess would be that they are selling more to other third world countries. This means the prices will not be as high as they could get by selling into the G7 countries, since they have a little bit more money. Now, one area of concern with these tariffs is higher prices in the U.S., and as we are fighting inflation, these tariffs will increase the price of products, not just from China, but here in the U.S., we may produce some of those products at a higher cost. Obviously, labor is more expensive here. We have more regulations, drives prices up. That then makes reducing inflation a little bit more difficult.
And it's something that, again, is hard because I don't know if you saw, Chase, but the Chinese did military air maneuvers over Taiwan. And they're just having trouble with their own economy. And I don't believe they would attack Taiwan. But you don't know what a crazy government would do. Yeah. And they're really they've overbuilt their real estate. They've got all these EVs. They've got all this solar stuff. And they can't sell it. And now we've taxed it. And I'm sorry, that will reduce the amount. Now, yeah, it still may be a better deal, but we're still going to slow down on purchasing that. So China, they can't sell it around the world. Their economy is not doing well, and these tariffs will be a big burden on China.
It was a great plan years ago to build and build and build to create, you know, I'm going to say wealth for your country and actually right. have a growing economy. But they have really struggled in that transition from building to consuming. And that internal consumption engine like we have here in the U.S. has not been able to be replicated there in China, which is why they have issues, why they have to continue to find areas to overbuild things so that they can keep their economy moving. But all that's doing, in my opinion, is it's creating more and more potential bubbles for them to deal with down the road.
Yeah, and it really is. I mean, China is, again, having a hard time. They're trying. What they try to do is they are still a communist country, but they try to use the same economy that we have here in the U.S., and the two just don't match up because they don't really have banks the way we have here. They have banks, but they don't really look at their earnings because the government's going to back them up. And when the government backs them up, well, who cares if they make a profit or not? But now they have a lot of debt, a lot of real estate sitting there. They're trying to produce a way out of it, but you know, I can get very political here, but I mean, now they're kind of being more friends with Russia. Well, we don't like that. So it's a problem for them. And back 10 years ago, we had great relations with China. They're not great any longer.
And I think it's a problem. Trump, we know, doesn't like China. Now, even the Biden administration, they're a lot tougher on China than I thought they were going to be, which I think is a problem for China because it's a wild card as to what they're going to do in response. I mean, you brought up the iPhones. We talked about the Tesla cars. And it's funny, Elon Musk totally changed his tune as to, oh, you know, China's going to, you know, destroy everybody because their EVs are so low priced. And he's like, well, no, I never said I wanted tariffs. You kind of insinuated that just a few months ago.
Right.
And I think he's worried about what China's going to do in response. And I know he has a factory there. And China, they've done this before. They could go in and be like, sorry, Elon, we're taking your factory. See you later. There's nothing you can do.
Nothing you can do. And I saw yesterday on the news that their sales of cars in China year over year are down like 26%. Not a good thing for a business. And I'm still shocked that Tesla trades where it does. And it is because of Elon Musk. He's great at talking about the good stuff, and he is a very smart guy. But that company, I think, is having some major problems inside.
Yeah, I mean that, and then we talk about the iPhones, and I know, you know, I saw an analyst on CNBC yesterday who was talking about how there's all these iPhones that are aging. I think that's a problem, because now I think people in China, instead of looking at their aging iPhone to renew and get a new iPhone, they're like, yeah, my iPhone is aging. I think I'm going to buy a Huawei phone. I think that's even more problematic. And I mean, we'll see how this all plays out, especially if China looks at implementing tariffs on Apple or implementing some types of penalties to drive up the cost there. I mean, I see there being potential problems, and I don't see relations getting stronger with China from here.
Kind of tease people a little bit. That meeting, or event, whatever you want to call it, with Apple is in about 2 weeks. We'll talk more about that afterwards, because that's supposed to be a saving grace for Apple. We're curious what they come out with. Will it be enough to convert people to say, yes, I want to buy a new iPhone? I don't think I'm going to, but we'll see. But we'll talk more about that in future shows, so be prepared for that. All this does come from our newsletter, which is a free newsletter that goes out every Friday at 5 o'clock by email. On that newsletter, we do talk about the UAW. They got booted out of a Mercedes. I think it was in Tennessee or Arkansas. Talk about oil companies, the travel season, Walmart annual sales compared to Amazon, stock buybacks, the PC markets. A lot of great information there for you. It is all free. All you have to do is go to the website, smartinvesting2000.com. Again, that's smartinvesting2000.com. Right in the middle of the page, you'll see the newsletter. Click on it, sign up for it. You'll get one in your inbox next Friday. All right, let's see. What time is it? I think it's time to talk about financial planning. And for that, we turn to our CFP, our financial planner, Harrison Johnson. Harrison, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well, guys. How are you doing?
Good, good. I like this topic. I know it's been around for a long time. I didn't talk to you ahead of time what you're talking about here, but the two monthly mortgage payments, it's been around for a long time. So I want to hear what your comment is as a CFP.
So, yeah, the question here is it better to make two mortgage payments during the month or just one? So by making a payment every 2 weeks, the only difference there is that by the end of the year, you will have made 26 half payments or 13 full payments instead of your normal 12, which basically means you are paying extra toward the principal, which will reduce the loan faster. If you were to actually make a payment twice a month for a total of 24 payments over the course of a year, you're not going to see any difference than if you had just made one monthly payment, 12 full payments out of the year. This is because with mortgage loans, the interest is based on the balance of the loan at the end of the month. So whether you pay one full payment or two half payments, the balance at the end of the month is still the same, so the monthly interest is still the same. Now, this is different than other types of loans like credit cards or HELOCs, where interest is calculated based on an average daily balance. With those loans, if you make multiple smaller payments, it will reduce the amount of interest due, and you will pay it down faster. But with a normal mortgage, the best way to make a payment is once per month, 2 weeks after the payment is due. So for example, your May payment is due on June 1st, but you won't have any extra interest or penalties as long as you pay it by June 15th. If you pay it sooner than that, those funds are essentially set aside and then applied to the loan on June 15th. So there's no benefit by making your normal payment early. If you wanted to make extra principal payments in addition to your normal payment, it's best to do that at the end of every month. However, you really should only be doing that if you have a high interest rate on your mortgage. Otherwise, you're most likely better investing those funds.
And Harrison, you brought up the point, and I think a lot of people don't realize this. Like, oh, I'll make my payment every 2 months or twice a month, every 2 weeks. I'll do it on the 15th and the 30th every month. Well, it's every 2 weeks, as you point out, not the 15th and the 30th, because as you point out, you'll get nowhere doing that. But I know people are doing that thinking they're doing something beneficial, because if you did every 2 weeks, it's going to be eventually odd times of the month when it'll come up.
Yeah. I had someone just reach out to me a couple of days ago and ask about this. And, you know, you hear about things and, you know, there's 52 weeks in a year. So if you're making a payment every 2 weeks, you're just making an extra payment. That's why it can you know, reduce the balance. But then the bigger question is, well, should you be making extra payments to your mortgage? If you have a 3% mortgage, I would say no. If you have a 10% mortgage, then maybe yes. But again, when you're making a mortgage payment, you don't have any other penalties or anything as long as you make it 2 weeks after the point that it's actually due.
And you know, you bring up the point of some people paying down their mortgage. I don't know why you would do it if it's a 3%, 4% rate. I think you're doing yourself an injustice. You should be talking to a financial planner about, well, what should you be doing if you have that extra cash flow?
Yeah, maybe you've got some more you can put into your retirement account. Maybe you've got some more that you can invest in something else. A 3% mortgage after tax, maybe a 2% after tax mortgage, you're not really getting that far ahead by, you know, paying that down too quickly.
Yeah, I mean, that's the big thing I always look at is what's the spread. I mean, even on money market accounts right now, you can find money markets paying 5%, so you could have very low risk. And I'm not recommending you do this, but you have very low risk, and you're making more money in interest than you're paying in interest. It's a very simple spread there. And, you know, if things did reverse and all of a sudden the money markets dip back down, let's say, then, yeah, maybe it makes sense, but it comes down to how you're investing the money.
Yeah, ultimately. And, you know, back to the original question of, well, you know, I know there's people out there that are making payments every 2 weeks and they don't feel it. You know, one payment a month, two payments a month doesn't matter. But what happens is there's 2 months out of the year where you're making three payments in that month. So you're really just making extra payments to the mortgage. And you might not feel it if it's every 2 weeks. But again, the financially correct thing would be to do is make your one payment a month because it's not saving you any interest. And then any extra that you have, apply to something that's, you know, earning or providing more value than the interest rate at 3%.
And Harrison, I think before people do that, they should talk to a financial planner because there's a break point to where it makes sense to do it. Is it 6%, 7%? What is that number? It depends on their situation. So again, talk to someone like yourself, a financial planner, to look at the whole situation to see what's best for them.
It definitely does depend on the individual situation because if you invest that money in a taxable account, okay, well, those gains will have income tax that you have to pay on it. You add the capital gain rate, so that's a little bit lower. If you're investing in something like bonds, like you guys were talking about earlier, that's taxed at a higher rate. If you're not getting an interest deduction on your mortgage, then that means that cost might be a little bit higher. So depends on the situation.
Great. Well, Harrison, thank you very much. We appreciate it, and we'll see you Monday at the office.
All right. Sounds good.
Okay. Bye-bye. All right. That wraps up the first half of the Smart Investing Show. We'll be right back with more great information on investing. Stay with us. You're listening to the Smart Investing Show with Brent and Chase. The first kicker took us when I hit the ground. End up like a dog that's been beat too much till you span. Alrighty, welcome back to the second half of the Smart Investing Show. We're going to go over some companies here for you, talk about investing in these companies, explain more to you about them, and just having a fun time talking about them. The first one to talk about is going to go to Home Depot, the home improvement retailer. Now, I'm sure many of you go to Home Depot. You probably go there. It's always crowded. Parking lot's full. But is it a good investment? Well, let's kind of look at it and see if it's worthwhile investing in Home Depot or not. Their symbol, by the way, is HD. About 73% institutional owned. They do have a high PE ratio of 21.8, just slightly above the industry at 21.3. And I say high because the history of the market is about 14 to 17. But 21.8 is right in line with the S&P 500, which is also expensive, I believe. Price to sales, 2.1 versus 1.7. That's expensive. Price to book value, 177 versus 42. So you are paying an awful lot for the value or the book value of this company. Price to cash flow, 15.4 versus 13.7. We do see that the PEG ratio is 6, which is high, but the industry is at 18.2, so probably good to avoid the company and the industry based on that. We do see, now this is disappointing, last year the earnings are down 9.1%. The industry is only down 3.5%. Sales for Home Depot also fell by 2.5%. The industry was down 4.7%. The analysts over 5 years only see earnings growth at 3.4%, slightly above the industry at 3.2%. They do pay a dividend of 2.8%, using 57% of the earnings to pay that out. We do see on the balance sheet, current ratio 1.3, that's okay, same as the industry. Debt equity, no problem here, 28 versus 17, that's okay. Net profit margin still pretty good for Home Depot, 9.8 versus 8.3, and return on equity, well, this is a strange number, 817 versus a negative 491 for the industry. I'll probably check the balance sheet here to see why that equity is so strange. And then return on invested capital, 31.8 versus 28. Jace, what do you got?
Yeah, so current price here for Home Depot, again, their ticker symbol is HD, $325.10. 52-week low is $274.26, and the 52-week high is $396.87. I was kind of looking at a long-term chart here, and actually back in 2021, it did cross over $400 a share. Then it pulled back. It kind of came back a little bit this year, came very close to getting that $400 mark, but has since pulled back. Going forward for the business, we go out to, let's see here, if I believe they report on a fiscal basis. So, yep, they report January 2026, estimated earnings per share $16.29. It gives us a target sell price of $270.41, so it's still expensive. Their forward PE multiple is still over 20 times.
And just to let you know, we like to invest in companies when they have a forward PE of around 10 to 12. As I said, I look at the stockholders' equity because I don't know why return equity is so high. Well, it's because the equity is only $1,820,000,000. That's very low compared to their assets and everything else. So that's why the return equity is so strange. But nothing else really there I can see. I mean, Home Depot is a great company. They got a lot of great products. A lot of people go there. But you're paying for a growth company, and the growth just does not seem to be there.
Well, I mean, I got some numbers as well. I mean, they actually just had their fifth consecutive quarter of year-over-year sales declines. I mean, obviously, they got a big boom during the COVID kind of hype, I'll say.
Right.
But frankly, even though it's down off those highs, to still trade at 20 times earnings after five consecutive quarters of year-over-year declines, and you look back to 2 years ago, sales are down 6.4%. So, I mean, there's no growth in that. And it's just something that I think is concerning. As you said, to be paying that much for a company, you should be seeing growth. And I frankly don't know how much growth they'll get going forward. I think they will return to growth, but I don't think you're going to see like 10, 15% growth on sales and earnings going forward. Yeah. You're not going to see a huge boom in home improvement. I just don't see that happening.
And Chase, we were talking in the office yesterday about the stock investors, more retail stock investors. I think now 64% of households, they do own stock in some form. And we talked about how that people, I think, just buy stock. Like, oh, Home Depot, it's good. Oh, Costco, it's good. Reminds me of, and you know this, a lot of people don't know this, but the Nifty 50 back in the 70s where people just bought the name, didn't care what it was. And that actually is what caused the great crash in 73, 74, because things were way overpriced. And they didn't have the growth, and they fell by 50%.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? Maybe Home Depot will go up because Costco trades at 50 times earnings. So you never know. I mean, it's just – and that's the – I'm going to say the hard part about investing. We will tell you what the valuations are. Now, why Costco trades at 50 times earnings with, I'm going to say, suboptimal growth, I can't tell you. I guess people like to go shopping there, so they buy the stock. But it's such a silly concept that – I mean, let me phrase this a different way. It's more expensive than NVIDIA.
You're right.
You pay
it is.
More for the earnings of Costco than you do for an NVIDIA. And, you know, why we think NVIDIA is expensive based off the valuations. I mean, a Costco is just so expensive. And you just don't know why. But to circle this back to Home Depot is you're essentially hoping that you're going to get multiple expansion and that you're going to find other investors that are willing to pay more than 20 times earnings. And frankly, for a business like this, I'm just not willing to pay more than 20 times earnings for a business with, I'm going to say, limited growth potential.
And I think you're on Fox 5 Wednesday, and I think you said you're talking about psychology investing. That's going to be such a great segment. I think they're letting you're going to do that one.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to tune in for that because it's just the things that people do. And it can work, you know, 1 year, 2 years, sometimes 5 years. And all of a sudden it doesn't work. What happened? Because it made no sense. The market, actually, the first stock was bought back, I think, in the late 1600s. So it's been going on for like 400 years. So just because you've seen something for 2, 3, 4, 5 years doesn't mean that's the norm. That's really a very short period when it comes to long-term investing.
Yeah, and I did want to say one other thing about Home Depot that I'm a little bit concerned with. They did actually announce an acquisition of SRS Distributions, a Texas-based specialty distributor of roofing, landscaping, and pool supplies for $18.25 billion. It was the company's largest acquisition in its history. So, I mean, that's a big one. And I know their balance sheet looks a little bit strange. I know they bought back a lot of stock, but I think, again, I don't like when companies reach for growth, and I think an acquisition like this could be Home Depot reaching for growth.
And we've seen companies over the years falter because they reach for growth, and I don't presume they paid cash for it. They probably raised their debt for it.
I'd assume so.
And then what happens, you got to make those payments, the interest rates payments, and it just causes problems. Actually, Red Lobster filed bankruptcy last week.
Yeah.
So, and again, it was a debt problem and earnings problem and so forth. So you got to be careful with companies on their acquisitions. Yeah, you want to grow the business, but you got to be careful what you pay for it, how much debt you're taking on. So again, I actually don't shop at Home Depot. I go to Lowe's.
Yeah, I'm not very handy, so I get a lot of stuff off Amazon, honestly.
Well, I'm not very handy either. I mean, I go to Lowe's and I get the solar lights for my plants, you know, so I can shine them and stuff. I'm not handy either. I have a handyman.
Well, I used to knock Amazon, but it's hard to beat Amazon, man. It comes straight to your door. It's so much easier.
Yeah, yeah. Although we did have, I bought something. No, I didn't buy an Amazon. That's a whole other story. We'll save that for another time. So, because I want to move on to the next company, because I know a lot of people love their pets, and this is something that as a pet owner, we thought maybe you'd like to invest in this. We got to look at the numbers. But to give you a reason why, I mean, when you look at what the average person spent on their pet in the U.S. back in 2013, it was $460. 2021, it jumped to $770. Now Forbes in 2024 says it's $1,533, and you got two dogs, so maybe you're spending twice that amount. I don't know.
Yeah,
I'm thinking about who I'm talking to. Yeah, you're pretty good with your money.
Yeah, I mean, for the most part, I mean, I still get them treats, and yeah. You know, it's funny. I'll take them to get a bath once in a while, and my neighbor was like, "Why do you take them to get a bath? You know, you have a bathtub." And I was like, "I don't know. It's kind of nice. They clip their nails. They do the gland expression, which I don't want to do that.
No,
you know?
No. Yeah, no. I don't know what that is, but it doesn't sound good.
Yeah, I'm like, you know, I'm not doing that. So I like to, you know, treat them every once in a while.
There you go. So, all right, well, let's talk about the company here. We're talking about Zoetis. Their symbol is ZTS, and they are a drug manufacturer specialty generic type company. So they do drugs for Alsi pets. Not much short on the company, 1.1%, 96% institutional owned. Gosh, they have a high PE ratio of 32.7 versus 108, which is even higher. Price to sales, 9 versus 1.8. Price to book value, 15.3 versus only 1.9. Price to cash flow, 32.6 versus 17. And then the PEG ratio going forward looks good, 3.1 versus 11.9. I got to say, sometimes that PEG ratio does not make sense because all of these other valuation ratios are very high, but the PEG ratio is low, and I know that's based on the price earnings divided by growth, but it just seems too good to be true. I'll put it that way. Look at the earnings over the last year. They are up 17.4%. The industry was down 2.3%. That's a positive. Sales did climb by 7.9% versus 1.9%. 5-year earnings growth 9.5% versus 8.6%. That's a positive. Unfortunately, they only pay a 1% dividend, using 30% of their earnings to pay that out. And look at the balance sheet here. We got a current ratio 3.3 versus 2.4. That's good. Unfortunately, the debt to equity is 1.3 versus 0.7. That's about our break point. We don't like to go above that. You can see if they got debt coming due, maybe they'll pay it off. But that is a concern for me. Net profit margin, very good, 27.4 versus a -0.6. And return on equity, wow, 47. Versus 9. So some good numbers, some bad numbers. What do you got going forward?
Yeah, current price here, again, for Zoetis, the ticker symbol ZTS, it's $170.07. 52-week low is $144.80, and the high, $201.92. You know, I was kind of looking. This company was spun out from Pfizer back in 2013. Looks like Zoetis went public and raised $2.2 billion. This is when Pfizer sold approximately 20% of its stake in Zoetis. 3 months later, Pfizer announced plans to spin off its remaining 80%. I bring this up because I looked at the 10-year return for Zoetis.
Yes.
459% is the 10-year return.
Wow.
Too bad Pfizer didn't keep some of those shares.
Yeah, they're probably saying the same thing. Like, why did we spin the whole thing off? We should have kept it. And I think, again, we talk about growing sales, growing revenue. I do believe, we didn't research this, but I do believe more and more people are spending, again, not just more money on their pets, but getting more pets. We talked to a lady yesterday by Zoom. She was in her home. She had, two dogs and I think a rabbit or two behind her. I mean, you know, people just love pets. They're very, very friendly.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, Harrison, our financial planner, they just got a, gosh, what's the dog's name? It's like a new Finland or
they
something.
Got that big white dog is what they
got. The new dog they got, it was a Great Pyrenees is what they currently have. The new, I think it's a new Finland. It's twice the size of.
What is it, a horse?
They're Benny. Benny is the Great Pyrenees. Yeah, I mean, it's a great big dog, but, you know, they love their pets too. So, you know, we're a pet firm, I guess. Well, I guess you don't have any pets you used to, but.
I used to. She died.
Yeah. So.
And I don't miss picking up the after nap. I guess I'll put it that way.
But I have not given the target sell price yet for Solana.
Yeah, I'm sorry. We got way off track. Let's get back to the numbers.
We're looking at December 2025. Estimated earnings per share, $6.37. Unfortunately, it's expensive as well. Give us a target sell price of $105.74. Forward PE's 26, 27 times. You do get a decent estimated growth on earnings. So it looks like they're, over the next few years, estimated to grow earnings about 10% on a compounded rate. So it's a good estimated growth, but still 26 times, 27 times is too expensive for my liking.
Yeah, and I thought this would be worth looking at because, again, I know how people love their pets, and I thought here's a high-demand industry. It'd be pretty good. But unfortunately, too expensive. And remember the company Chewy? I don't know where it stands now, but I know it went way up. And then went way down. You got to be careful of companies like that. But Chewy is another pet company that just and I thought delivering the pet food was just too expensive. Again, who are they competing with?
Amazon.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I know. I think they're expanding more into trying to do kind of like veterinarian services and things of that nature. But I mean, that's a tough field to get into.
Yeah. It really is. Yeah. So, all right. What time is it? You know what time it is? It's time to talk to Robert Behick, president of Countywide Mortgage Lending. Let's talk about mortgages and real estate. Robert, you with us?
I am. Good morning.
Well, good morning. I like the topic today because I've often wondered this about the median home price in San Diego versus the United States. I know our houses are much more expensive, but I want to hear some good facts about why and where we stand.
Well, here's the thing. The reason I wanted to bring this to folks' attention is because of the misinformation that's out there. I just happened to see a piece that a local real estate agent who will remain nameless put out there, and he was talking about how prices fell so much. And it's just the lack of understanding. It's sad that folks don't understand what the median price of a home is. It doesn't mean that prices are going down. What it means is that cheaper homes are selling more than expensive homes.
That is true.
When we
the median price.
See those national numbers and home sales per unit, so there's more sales of homes, but they talk about that median home price is going down. It's because there's cheaper homes are selling more than more expensive homes are.
And I remember statistics, there was one that's better, and I think that I remember there's a median, the median, and the mode. I think the mode is the one that's right in the middle. That would be a better
one. Mode's the most occurring.
Most occurring?
The median is right in the middle, and the mode is like your simple average where you have 100 homes.
You mean
take the average.
Mean is the average.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. Okay. Sorry, Robert, we got off track. I just want to understand that.
No, it's all good. But now you switch to just the San Diego numbers for San Diego County, and the median price is up 4.6% this year.
Wow.
So that doesn't mean that prices are going up. It just means that more expensive homes are selling than cheaper homes.
Or it could be less cheaper homes are selling and more. Yeah. So, this is why a number means nothing at all until you have something to compare it to and understand that number.
It's why you need somebody who's a professional that can help you explain. Because what happens, guys, is quite frankly, I have clients that are going out and making offers, and they're going, well, I heard that the prices were coming down, so I don't want to offer as much. And it's so competitive right now that they don't have a chance if they want to come under asking price for most properties. There are the extreme exception, the property that's been on the market for a year and a half, that kind of stuff. But if it just came on last week and they have 8 offers and you want to come in under asking, sayonara.
And again, I think this is where you always talk about having that conversation because there's different homes. And I'm going to just pull out 3. I mean, you had the lower priced homes, the mid priced homes, and the higher priced homes. They're not going to all react the same way. So therefore, the person you deal with has to know has to be experienced to understand what's going on in the market, all the markets.
It's absolutely the case. And being Memorial Day weekend, and thanks to the folks that sacrifice their lives so we can live in this great country and their families on top of it, it's one of the things that we strive to help VA folks and all folks all together. So I appreciate it very much so.
Well, we appreciate your comments and your commentary on this stuff. And what it is, it's important for people to talk to somebody, have that conversation with someone like yourself to understand when to wait for a better offer or when to put in a lower offer, when not to. I mean, it's amazing to me. People read a headline, as you're talking about, and they make bad decisions.
They do. Uninformed. Yeah. And it's unfortunately, you have a real estate agent with a license out there expanding on the same information. It's just crazy. So we need to get the right information out there.
Well, that's why you're here, Robert, to educate people on real estate and financing in real estate. And we appreciate you spending your time here every week with us to explain to people. And we will talk to you more next week.
Happy Memorial Day weekend, everybody.
You too. Bye-bye. Again, that's Robert Behick, president of Countywide Mortgage Lending. Again, they are one of the top 100 mortgage companies in America since 2012. If you want to contact Robert, this is a cell phone number. You can call him directly at 760-443-3821. Again, that's 760-443-3821. I've known this guy for probably 25 years. Great guy to talk to, very easygoing, not high pressure. Give him a call or go to the website, countywidemtg.com. Again, that's countywidemtg.com. You can catch him there as well.
And just a reminder, Countywide Mortgage Lending is a division of Golden Empire Mortgage, Inc., NMLS number 1104585, licensed by the Department of Financial Protection and Innovation under the California Residential Mortgage Lending Act. Countywide Mortgage Lending is an equal housing lender and proud member of the BBB. And before we go to that last company, I did just want to say one thing. And it is so funny that the numbers Robert's talking about with the median home price, yes, and so forth. You see these reports and they're like, oh, the lower end of the market is just not doing well. If you look at, and I think their number is like $100,000. Sales are down 33. I'm like, $100,000? Like, number one, we don't have that here in San Diego County, obviously.
Right.
But obviously, as prices go up, that they draw the line at $100,000, like, yeah, you're going to have no sales and no listings at that level. So, I mean, as you said, I mean, you have to understand a number means nothing at all unless you understand the details of it. And you can find facts and data to support your opinion,
right,
and you can twist numbers any way you want them, yeah, at the end of the day.
Really understand what you're looking at in the market that you're looking at, because don't compare a $5 million home if you can only afford a $1 million home. It's going to be different. Make sure, again, the person you talk to understands it.
Well, so, especially it's like you have like 10 houses, let's right, say, and last year, five of them were above $1 million, and now this year, only two of them are above $1 million. Yeah, as Robert said, that's going to have a big impact on the, yeah, median home price. It has, yeah, nothing to do with the individual listing, but just the market. So,
and Chase, I couldn't resist. I had to look at Chewy, what the price was, because we're talking about Zoetis, a pet company. Chewy, 52-week high was $40.78. The recent price was $16.57. Their low was $14.69. So they have not recovered. And again, that's a pet company. And we won't go with the numbers. Maybe we'll do it another time. But I just want to kind of point that out, that they're still down. And they were a high flyer. And if you paid $40 a share for it, you're still waiting for a while.
If you want, you can go back to our podcast on March 30th. We did talk about Chewy.
We did.
Yeah.
I don't remember that.
I mean, that was 2 months ago now, so.
Okay, yeah, I'm older now. My memory doesn't go back that far. Well, let's talk about Altria. I want to say Altria Group, but I think, let me put the symbol on. I can actually see.
It's Altria Group, Inc. Yep.
It is Altria Group, Inc. Okay, so let's take a look at that. Again, I'll say they're a cigarette company. They're in the tobacco industry. I'm surprised on this. Tobacco, the shares short only 2.4%. You would think it'd be going down, but we'll go on here. Institutional ownership is a 62.2%. P.E. ratio, very attractive, 9.5 versus 63. Price of sales, 3.9, above the industry at 2.3. There is no book value to this company. What that means, you take away all the liabilities from the assets, there's no value there. But we do have price of cash flow of 8.8 versus 9.5. Peg ratio is 2.4, very good compared to the industry at 15.6. Earnings per share grew, wow, by 53.7% when the industry was down 46.3%. Sales were down 0.9% when the industry was up 5.7%. They have a five-year growth on this company on their earnings of 3.7% versus 4.7%. And again, I always think that less people are smoking, but not based on this. Something strange here. What is very attractive with Altria Group is the dividend. It's an 8.6% dividend with a payout ratio of 81.2%. You buy this company for the dividend. That's what you do. Much better yield than bonds, by the way. Mm-hmm. And then we do see on the balance sheet a current ratio 0.5 versus 1.1. That's very risky. Debt to equity, nothing there because there is no equity for the company. Net profit margin, wow. 41.4%. I say wow because that's very high, but they could have sold an asset or something else. So you'd really have to check that number. And then return on equity, a negative 165 versus a positive 21.5 for the industry. What do you got?
Yeah, and very important, Altria Group, that they are the U.S. tobacco company. I believe they used to have Philip Morris in there as well, but then they spun that out, and Altria is now U.S., and Philip Morris is the international brand. And I was kind of looking, they do have some other things, obviously, outside of just the cigarettes, but they do have, you know, Black and Mild as a brand. They do have Copenhagen, Skoll, Red Seal, Husky brands. I'm not familiar with all of those. Also, too, they do have the oral nicotine pouches, which, frankly, I know is more popular with, I'm going to say, Gen Z.
But wait a minute. Isn't that the one that stops you from smoking, or you get nicotine directly?
Do you get the nicotine directly. So you kind of like, it's like instead of doing tobacco, chewing tobacco, you do a pouch, and it gives you the nicotine kind of, I'd say, high.
You say
something.
Pouch or patch?
Pouch.
Pouch.
Yeah.
Okay.
I thought it was nicotine pouch. So you put it in your mouth, and yeah, it's a different type of thing. But I know it's very popular with kind of kids in their 20s, I would say.
Really?
And actually, I have a few friends that also enjoy it as well. But that brand that they have is called On, and they do have the e-vapor products. And I don't believe they may have been the ones that had issues with the whole Juul debacle a few years ago.
Right.
I'm not exactly sure on that. If you did own it or are looking at buying that stock, I would look at that because I knew that was a big problem, the Juul issues. They were getting sued and so forth. I'm not sure if that ever panned out or what happened there, but... Something you want to understand.
I think that's over. And I know you haven't gotten the numbers out yet, but there have been lawsuits against them. And the thing with the tobacco, I think you get, what, tongue, cheek cancer, I think, and stuff like that, right? Yeah.
Yeah. It's a tough thing, I guess, long term. So you got to be careful, obviously.
And I know that it's not good for your teeth. I've seen people like, oh, man, your teeth are all yellow.
Yeah. You know, it's definitely, you don't do it for health reasons. I'll leave it at that.
That's a good way to say it.
But back to the numbers for Altria Group. Again, their ticker symbol is MO, M-O, $45.49. Their 52-week low is $39.07, and their 52-week high, wow, $100.79. What the heck is going on with the stock price? I mean, that's
Wait, I don't see that here.
Is that an issue?
Yeah, okay. I think, could you look at a different thing?
There's definitely an error on that.
Yeah, that's an error, because I see the 52-week high as a 46.60. And the low is 39.06.
Okay, here it is. You know what happened? Pulled up Philip Morris real quick, and it didn't transfer over that particular portion of the tile.
Okay.
So I was looking at, I think maybe that was Philip Morris's combined with Altria Group. So Now I have it. Yeah, 52-week range, 39.07 is the low, 46.60, current price 45.49. So that looks more in line with what I was anticipating. Nothing outside the norm there. Now, if we go forward, we go to December 2025. I do see estimated earnings per share of $5.30. It gives us a target sell price of $87.98. So, I mean, from a valuation perspective, it looks very nice. I still am, I guess, somewhat surprised that they are expecting, I'd say, low to mid single digit growth on earnings. I think a lot of that likely will come from price appreciation. I don't know much about the tobacco market, but we talked about this. I don't think it's a growing market. I could be wrong on that, but
I think I agree with you. I think it's a price is growing because supposedly more people are quitting smoking. I don't see how that can happen. I know we're kind of here in San Diego and California, we're more healthy, but back east, I think a lot of people do smoke. And I was shocked. I looked up the price of a carton of cigarettes, which is 10 packs, is between, depending on the brand, you get $30 to $60. Now, if you're smoking a pack a day in 10 days, you're spending as much as $60 on cigarettes.
Yeah.
I just don't get it. I
you know, I don't want to equate this to the gasoline market, but it's kind of similar, a similar philosophy, I guess, is what I'll say, going back to earlier in the show. I don't think I'd buy the stock, even though the valuations look good. I just don't see this as a growing market. And right. I like businesses where you can get good valuations, but still a growing market. And I just don't see that with Altria Group.
Shoot, I had more to say on that, but the closing bell came real quickly.
Yeah.
All righty. Thank you for listening to the Smart Investing Show. It is for informational purposes only and should not be used as investment advice. If you'd like to discuss in more detail your investment needs, have other investment questions, feel free to call myself, Brent Wilsey, or Chase Wilsey at 858-224-0004. Again, that's 858-224-0004. Or go to our website, smartinvesting2000.com. That's smartinvesting2000.com. You can also listen to podcasts there, sign up for the newsletter, many things there. So thanks for listening to the Smart Investing Show. We'll be back right here next week.
I did all that, and may I say.